Good morning. The first item of business is general questions, and at question number one, I call Liam MacArthur.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on work to extend the application of road equivalent tariff to Northern Isles ferry routes.
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop.
The Scottish Government remains committed to providing affordable ferry fares for the Northern Isles, and we have reduced fares where we have been able to do so. Significant fare reductions have been introduced on routes from Aberdeen to Orkney and Shetland, including a 20% discount on cabins, a 3 years fare freeze for islanders, and a freeze on all fares in 23-24. Ferry fares policy, including RET, is currently being reviewed. The draft Islands Connectivity Plan strategic approach paper, published for consultation on the 1st of February 2024, made a number of proposals around ferry fares policy, including RET. The online consultation concluded on the 6th of May 2024, and responses are being collated and analysed. Further detail on next steps and timescales will be confirmed in due course.
Liam MacArthur.
The SNP introduced RET on Western Isles ferry routes in 2008. Since then, the excuses for not providing the same cheap fares on Pentland Firth routes have changed almost as often as transport ministers. Last year, the Transport Secretary advised me that under the UK Subsidy Control Act, the government couldn't move forward because of potential distortions of the market. Scotland Office subsequently confirmed that the Act allows devolved administrations and local authorities to give subsidies that are tailored to local needs. We've also seen an increase in ferry fares from April this year of 8.7%. So isn't it the case that Scottish ministers have been stringing along people in Orkney for 16 years with no intention of providing them with a fair deal on lifeline ferry routes across the Pentland Firth?
Cabinet Secretary.
That is not the case, and indeed a 3 years fares freeze for islanders and a freeze on all fares in 2023-24 was a significant subsidy and support for islanders at a time when the operations were increasing because of obviously increased wage costs, and as everybody would have remembered, eye-watering energy cost increases, and fares were frozen at that level for a considerable period of time. In relation to subsidy control and competition law, the Scotland Office can speak for themselves, but I would not interpret their remarks on this to be a get-out clause on subsidy control and competition matters. And as the member will well know, because he's an experienced member of this chamber, competition and law and subsidy control matters are very serious issues and can lead to legal challenge of the government and can have severe consequences. So I wouldn't take that that issue lightly. And those issues have been continuous over the period of time that he refers to.
I call Rhoda Grant for a brief supplementary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Would the Cabinet Secretary confirm that state aid rules and indeed competition law no longer is a barrier to having RET on those Northern Island routes, and would she confirm that the people of Orkney and Shetland are going to enjoy the same subsidies as people in other islands?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I would explain to the Minister that Brexit is still happening, and one of the consequences of Brexit is it's not a get-out-of-jail-free on state aid issues. Indeed, part of the agreements that the UK government made continuing with the EU was that they would still continue to have competition law and subsidy control measures that would enable the equivalence of activity as was previously. So I think there's a misunderstanding by the member, and I'm happy to try and explain that in more detail at a later date if she so chooses.
Thank you. Grateful for concise questions and responses. At question number two, I call Sarah Boyack.
To ask the Scottish Government when it will introduce legislation and climate targets as announced by the Net Zero Secretary in her ministerial statement on the 18th of April.
Cabinet Secretary Mary McCallum.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government's commitment to achieving net zero by 2045 is unwavering. However, we must now act on the Committee on Climate Change's long-standing position that the interim 2030 target set by Parliament on a cross-party basis is beyond what can be achieved. We will therefore bring forward legislation as soon as practicable to ensure that our emissions pathway takes account of latest advice, and I would take the opportunity to ask members across parties to collaborate with me on this issue and to ensure that we follow the CCC's advice in this regard.
Sarah Boyack.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, but say that the clarity on what is meant by introducing expedited legislation, as she said in the Chamber when she made her statement, to address matters that the Climate Change Committee raised and ensure that our legislative framework better reflects the reality of long-term climate policy making. Has the Cabinet Secretary given up her plan to bring forward that legislation in an expedited manner, because we are waiting for it now? And is it not the case that the Cabinet Secretary, that the longer the Scottish Government delays this legislation, the longer Scotland goes without a climate change plan, and the longer we urgently wait for action to tackle the climate emergency?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I understand Sarah Boyack's points. However, I can absolutely confirm to her that my intention remains the same. Indeed, I had a long session with the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee on this point earlier in the week. I want the legislation to be brought forward as soon as possible. I want the bill to be as narrow as possible to address the impediment to progress that we're currently facing as regards the 2030 progress, but to remove that as soon as we can, so that we can continue making progress on this issue, which is very important to me, and which I understand is also very important to Sarah Boyack.
Brief supplementary, Bob Dorris.
Thank you, President Officer. Full delivery of Scotland's climate policies requires full funding, yet the UK Government will cut around 9%, £1.5 billion from Scotland's capital budget. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, given the Climate Change Committee has called for partnership working between Scotland and Westminster, has the Scottish Government had any indication from Westminster that these cuts, which undermine climate commitments, will be reversed?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, Bob Dorris is absolutely right to point out both the significant costs in moving to net zero and how our ability to make the investments that are required is being undermined by the UK Government's failure to inflation-proof their budget. I very firmly believe that, done correctly, investment in net zero is an economic win. Indeed, the Chair of the Scottish Fiscal Commission, Professor Graeme Roy, recently said doing nothing, not responding to the challenge of climate change, will be far more expensive and damaging to public finances than investing in net zero. It's simply not an option. So I put that call to current and future UK governments, and I urge them to reverse Scotland's capital cut.
Edward Mountain.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. The Permanent Secretary has made it quite clear that this legislation that's being talked about can be introduced, and introduced quickly. Given that it's got to be introduced and agreed before November, will the Cabinet Secretary undertake to ensure that there is sufficient time for not only the committee to consider the information in the draft legislation, but also the people of Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I absolutely will. I would just reiterate what I said to Sarah Boyack, that I want to see this legislation brought forward as soon as practicable, and part of that is about the capacity of our committees, and indeed the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee, which Edward Mountain chairs. I will be sure to engage with Mr Mountain on timetabling as part of planning for that bill.
Thank you. Question number three, Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what it is doing to support BSL users across Scotland to access culture in light of the publication of Scotland's Census 2022 report on language, which found that 117,300 people can use BSL.
Cabinet Secretary Kate Forbes.
Apologies, Presiding Officer. Hopefully that works now. Let me start that again, thanking Karen Adam for the question. We want to ensure that everybody can access and engage with cultural opportunities, and that includes BSL users. And in the BSL National Plan published just last year, we committed to supporting BSL users to take part in culture and the arts as participants, audience members and professionals. And one of the examples of that funding is that Creative Scotland's regularly funded organisation network includes Solar Bear, that works with deaf and hearing actors, theatre makers, artists and young people. And in addition, targeted funding has directly supported the development of a deaf leader in the artistic director role.
Karen Adam.
I thank the Deputy First Minister for that answer. The census revealed that BSL users now make up 2.2% of the population, almost as many as the 2.5% of the people who can use Gaelic. Both Gaelic and BSL are national languages of Scotland, and it's fantastic that Gaelic has dedicated funding streams to support artists celebrating the language and the heritage. BSL has a lower profile in the arts and culture sector. With that in mind, what more can be done to support great initiatives like the Edinburgh Deaf Festival, which I'm hoping to take my father to later this year?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I would certainly be keen to work with Karen Adam to ensure that the profile of the work around supporting those with BSL is as high profile as possible. I think we should be supporting all of Scotland's languages, and both Gaelic and BSL, as Karen Adam said, are national languages. So perhaps the offer there is to meet with Karen Adam and to look at those specific initiatives and how we can work to support her objectives.
Question number four, Fulton MacGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to ensure that local authorities are able to provide full-time schooling for children with complex additional support needs.
Cabinet Secretary Jenny Gilruth.
As members will be aware, local authorities have a duty under the Additional Support for Learning legislation to both plan and provide support for children and young people with additional support needs. This includes those with complex additional support needs. Despite the challenging financial climate we face, spending on additional support for learning reached a record high of £926 million in 2022-23. The Scottish Government also provides £11 million of funding each year to directly support pupils with complex additional support needs and services to children and families.
Fulton MacGregor.
Yeah, I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. Recently, I had the pleasure of meeting my constituent, Nicholas McLennan, aged 9, and his parents at my surgery. Nicholas has had no full-time education for 18 months, despite the best efforts of the fabulous Drum Park School, also in my constituency. This young man's needs are very complex and include having global developmental delay, being unable to speak and eat, and his parents tell me they are concerned that the lack of education has had a very detrimental impact on his overall wellbeing. Despite representation from myself and others, the Council have knocked back a request at a specialist placement in nearby Cumbernauld, where his needs could be met on a full-time basis. Can I therefore ask the Minister what further support can be given to children like Nicholas to ensure that they receive the education that they deserve and are entitled to?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I thank the member for bringing his constituent's case to my attention. First of all, I'm extremely sorry to hear about his experience and those of his parents too, particularly the challenges he's had in accessing his right to education. Clearly, there might be specific healthcare considerations in this case. However, the Education Authority, as I understand it, North Lanarkshire Council, does remain responsible for ensuring the appropriate educational support is provided. To that end, I would strongly encourage Nicholas's parents to engage with North Lanarkshire Council to fully understand why this placement has been refused and what the next steps might be. The Enquire service, which is funded by the Scottish Government, can also help to provide them with further advice on this matter. The legislation on the presumption of mainstreaming has very clear exceptions to allow children and young people to learn in a special school or in specialist units if that would best meet their needs. And while school placements are, of course, a matter for our councils, parents do have the right to make a placing request to the school of their choice. And whilst I cannot interfere in this specific case, I would certainly welcome if Fulton MacGregor could provide further details on this particular case so that my officials can provide more detailed advice.
Thank you. Again, I'd be grateful for concise questions and responses. Question number five, I call Annabel Ewing.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has to support cultural activities in the Cowdenbeath constituency.
Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson.
The Scottish Government supports a range of cultural activities in communities across Scotland. We also provide targeted support for culture through funding of local authorities and public bodies, including Creative Scotland. Our funding to the Youth Music Initiative has supported projects in Cowdenbeath. These offer meaningful music-making opportunities to young people, helping to build their confidence and enhance their attainment. Projects supported include Charanga, a digital resource which supports class teachers to deliver progressive music programmes, and Fishy Music, which helps pupils develop their own music around a curricular topic.
Bill Ewing.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer, and whilst the references he has made to various projects are indeed welcome. I think, nonetheless, it would be fair to say that local groups would welcome greater support than they have had to date. But looking to the immediate future, with many community events planned to mark the 40th anniversary of the miners' strike, including in Ballingrey on Saturday, June 15th, what specific support does the Scottish Government intend to offer?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the Scottish Government recognises the significant impact that the miners' strike continues to have in communities across Scotland, and that's why we brought forward legislation to provide a pardon to miners and other participants in the strike. And we also continue to call on the UK Government to undertake a full UK-wide public inquiry into the strike. I appreciate that Ms Ewing wrote to the former Deputy First Minister about the anniversary event taking place in Ballingrey in June. My colleague Tom Arthur, the Minister for Employment and Investment, has confirmed that he will be in attendance.
Question number six, Graham Simpson.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government how it plans to take forward the recommendations in the Transport Scotland report. There's an app for that, Women's Safety on Public Transport in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
It's unacceptable for anyone, especially women and girls, to feel unsafe travelling on public transport in Scotland, including on our railway. On the 15th of May, I met with British Transport Police to discuss how we might prevent and reduce antisocial behaviour on Scotland's railway, including consideration of campaigns which promote and encourage the use of the Railway Guardian app. The app is operated by British Transport Police, who keep it under review and how it might be enhanced. The app can be downloaded via the British Transport Police website or via the App Store or Google Play Store. And more generally, discussions continue through the Violence Against Women and Girls Policy Forum about the role technology can play in awareness raising, education and empowerment, creating sustainable societal and behavioural change as part of a broader community safety approach in Scotland.
Graham Simpson.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and I'm pleased to hear that she's spoken to British Transport Police, but I'm sure she'd agree with me that women should not have to rely on apps to ensure their safety on public transport. So given that, what progress is the Scottish Government making with regards to the changes identified in its own report from March last year, such as transparent bus stops, improved network coverage and visible staffing like guards on trains, backed by my friends in the RMT?
Cabinet Secretary.
So visibility of staff is really important, and there has been an increase in the safety team that's operating, targeting particular areas. I think he's right to say that everybody has a responsibility, and that includes men on trains. And the Speak Up Interrupt campaign that was launched on the July 2022 has actually had a good uptake. So there is something about how collectively we as a society tackle antisocial behaviour, how we address it. And I was very pleased at the most recent stakeholder meeting I had, the White Ribbon campaign, were very good at identifying how generally men and women, but particularly men, can help in that regard. But happy to continue that discussion with Mr Simpson.
Question number seven, Colin Beattie.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the progress of the Sheriff Hall roundabout project.
Cabinet Secretary.
Given the large number of objections received following publication of draft orders, a public local inquiry was held from the 31st of January to the 8th of February 2023. The independent reporter submitted her conclusions and recommendations to the Scottish Government in October 2023. This is under active consideration prior to advice being provided to ministers and a decision being made by Scottish ministers on whether to complete the statutory process. While we are keen to see the improvements delivered as soon as possible, the statutory right for individuals to have their say on proposals cannot be set aside.
Colin Beattie.
The Sheriff Hall roundabout is used heavily and regularly creates a bottleneck of traffic to the detriment of my constituents, including local businesses. Completion of this project has huge public support, and there are serious concerns over the perceived delay. Whilst I appreciate the need to reduce our reliance on car transport to reach our net zero targets, does the Scottish Government agree with me that encouraging the use of public transport should not equal restricting improvements to road infrastructure?
Cabinet Secretary.
It needs to be both. We need to continue to improve road infrastructure for safety, asset management and effective traffic flow, for example, for potential bus lanes and for car use. The vision for our national transport strategy is that we will have a sustainable, inclusive, safe and accessible transport system, helping to deliver that healthier, fairer, more prosperous Scotland. And clearly, in terms of the investment hierarchy, transport options that focus on the need to travel sustainably and reduce inequalities are prioritised.